Hi there, my name is Darren Campbell from PubNub Developer Relations, and this is a tutorial for our Chat SDK. So you can use this SDK if you're developing applications in JavaScript or TypeScript where you need to easily add chat functionality, and you can find everything you need to get started in the GitHub repository that's associated with this SDK. There you'll find the demo application and the Getting Started app. And what I'm going to do in this tutorial is take the Getting Started app, show you how to get up and running with it, and then add some more features onto it so you can make it a little bit more feature rich and functional. I'm going to assume that you've already downloaded and cloned the GitHub repository, as well as obtained your PubNub publish and subscribe keys. If you're following along in the future and the repository has been updated, I'll also include the commit ID of the latest commit at the time of recording in the description of this tutorial or the accompanying text so that you can follow along and everything will be in sync. So I have loaded here the repository itself in VS Code. You can use whichever code editor you're most comfortable with. And the sample I'm going to be looking at is under JS Chat, Samples, and then this Getting Started app. And then under SRC, most of the code, in fact, all of the code that we'll be modifying is in this TSX file here, app.tsx. This is a React application. The Chat SDK itself is written in TypeScript, so you don't have to use React. You could use React Native, Ionic, anything that supports TypeScript. We are framework agnostic. Let's just give a little bit more space here. And the first thing you need to do in order to get the application itself running is to provide it with some PubNub publish and subscribe keys. So I've gone ahead off camera and obtained those keys. But the important part of the application that you want to look at first of all is where we're initializing the chat object. You see, we have this chat.init. We're passing into it a publish key and a subscribe key. And these are actually, in this sample, being obtained from an environment variable. You could just hard code the strings here, but we're going to follow along with the sample application itself and provide these in environment variables. So you want to find this env.example down here, just create a copy of that and then rename it to .env and then provide the publish and subscribe keys up here. So I've just got those. So as you're copying these in, make sure you have them around the right way. Again, at the time of recording, subscribe and publish are in that order, whereas in the admin portal, it will often be in the other way around, publish, subscribe, yeah, that way. So having copy those in once, there we go, save. Return to the app.tsx, and you see immediately we have a agent running here. I'll just load the other agent. Obviously, I have gone ahead off camera and run the yarn command, yarn dev. So the way the application works by default, and this is one thing that we will change in a subsequent step, is you are assigned a random ID. So the IDs, or I should say the users, are these people up here. So we have support agent and support user. So just go ahead, refresh the page until one of your users is assigned to the user. Here we are. So here we have Mary, and just out of the box, we're able to send messages from one to the other. So I can say from John here, hi, Mary. And then from Mary, we can say, hi, John. So just a few things to notice. The users themselves have IDs, they have names, they have additional custom properties. All of this we can specify within PubNub, and it will be stored on the server. Like, you don't have to store every user in every client as a JSON, a series of JSON objects. This is obviously just because it's a very simple application, just designed to show the principles of the thing. We will make things a little bit more advanced as we go through this tutorial, but at the very basics, we can send messages. This would scale to any number of users. Geographically, we could have the users located anywhere. And you saw the time between messages being sent and received was imperceptible to the human eye. So that's the application up and running. Let's dive into some of the source code behind it. So I'm going to go through the Getting Started application now, essentially line by line. I just want to explain how the Chat SDK is used to bring that Getting Started app to life and some of the basic principles of the SDK itself. Things to watch out for as we go along. We have four essentially basic data types that the Chat SDK will use. So there's this concept of users. So a user is someone who is partaking in a conversation. The way that you facilitate those conversations is through channels. So if it's a one-to-one chat, then it will be a direct channel. If it's a group chat, it will be a group channel, but it's the means over which a conversation happens. As a user joins or leaves a channel, that's how you get a membership object created. So you can imagine a user joining a channel has a membership associated with that. And then finally, messages are the data type that gets sent across the channel. When you send a message, that's the payload that encapsulates the data that's sent across. Let's just go through this line by line. I won't dwell too much, but I'll just point out important things as we come across them. So first thing is importing the chat SDK itself. We didn't have the separate step where we had to yarn add the SDK because we're actually running within the same mono repo as the SDK itself. But with your external application, you would be adding the SDK. I encourage you to check out the documentation for additional information about how that is done. We have declared locally in this sample the user data. So this is the data that defines the users who are going to participate in the conversations. You are not going to be defining this locally in production. This is obviously just done to keep things simple. But it again, it does allow us to show the basic principles. I've got the code shortly down below, which will create and retrieve those users for you. Just got the logic of assigning a random user here. That's something we'll sort out shortly. Some React state. This is obviously a React application. You're not locked into React with the chat SDK. Like I mentioned before, it could be any framework or any development principle which supports TypeScript. We've got the logic for the send function. So when you press the send button or hit enter, you are calling the send text method on the channel. Send text is not the only thing we support. You can also send files. You could send rich data, I guess you could describe it, like links or mentioned users. I'll come to mentioned users at the end of this tutorial. What else have we got? Just some management of the message lists. When you connect to a channel, this is the way that you retrieve or you receive updates when a message comes in. So you know to update the list of messages that are being shown to the user. So you see here we are updating this internal messages state that we've got, but this is all part of the channel.connect callback. In the initialization, we have this like large initialize chat method. So this is where we initialize the chat object itself. This is the first thing you want to do with the chat SDK. I've already covered the publish and subscribe key, but I didn't yet mention the user ID. So the user ID is an ID that you want to assign and make sure that it is unique for every user. And also it is retained by that user across different times they access the SDK. Obviously we're storing metadata associated with each of these users. They've got a name, they've probably got an avatar, they've got an email, they've got all sorts of other stuff associated with them on the server. We want to make sure they have access to that when they re-log in. You could reuse whichever ID is provided by your identity provider, or you could use a different ID. It's up to you, as long as that ID is unique and retained by the user, PubNub is happy. And then we're just setting up some of the data that's going to be associated with the conversation. Maybe I'll take this from the bottom up. So here we're creating a direct conversation. This is going to create a channel, which is going to be a one-on-one channel. So there's only going to be two participants. There are additional methods to create a group channel or a public channel. In fact, I'll show how to create a group channel in a future part of this same tutorial. What gets returned after you create the channel is the channel itself, as well as I don't use it, or the sample app doesn't use it, but there is also membership data that's returned along there. So you get the membership of yourself with the channel, as well as membership of the other user. Here, we're not doing anything with it. We're just creating the channel. I had to look up what an interlocutor is. This is someone else who is taking part in the conversation formally. So we're declaring that user here. It's a good example of something which you're probably not going to be doing at the client level in production. So creating users, obviously the logic here is saying, well, get the user. If the user doesn't exist, then create that user. You probably want to create the user after the user registered, and that's going to be a call that only authorized clients or authorized servers, most likely, have access to do. We have this concept of the access manager where you can lock down who has access to which API calls based on UUIDs. It's a very powerful mechanism, but it's not used in the sample because we're trying to keep things simple. We're trying to show things working entirely within the browser. So just bear that in mind. And then what else are we doing? So we are setting up the variables here, calling initialize, so render message part will be used later on when we start to parse out that rich text, like I was talking about, things like links, mentions. By default though, the sample app is only using the text part of the message. So you see hello over there. And then we've got the rendering logic. So messages is being stored as an array. So we're just going through those. This sample app will obtain the user information from its local array up here. You probably, again, wouldn't do that in production. There is a get details object you can call on the user, and that will give you the name and the avatar associated with the user to place here. Messages are at this stage that message type, which I'd mentioned earlier. So that will have a number of properties associated with it. For example, the time token, which enables you to use it as a key. But then we also have additional utilities associated with the Chat SDK. And the best example of that is a time token utils, which gives you methods to convert that time token into user readable dates, times, whatever you want to do. We're just parsing through the user objects, the message objects, and displaying them on the screen. Like I said, we only have text messages, but the application itself is future-proofed for rich data, and I'll get to that towards the end of the tutorial. But the only other thing is handling the input. So we've got some handlers for the message input field here, as well as the send button. And with that, kind of goes through the whole application. So I think it's about time to start making some changes and adding some functionality to the basic getting started app. So the first thing I'd like to change, and this is very much a quality of life improvement for me, which was as I was starting to go through and make some modifications to the getting started app, I got quite frustrated that every time I would refresh the page, I would be assigned a new user. So here we have two Marys, for example. I just wanted to make it deterministic which user I get as I refresh the page. So there's obviously multiple ways you could do that. The sample app is just trying to keep things simple. It knows it has two users and it's going to assign you one at random. I thought it would be a better idea to use a query string in the URL. So I'm just going to comment out the randomness of the user data. So user data is this JSON array here. And I'm just going to say const randomize users equals, and then I'm going to say if the document.location.search.includes, and I'm just going to say if it's the agent, then I want you to do the exact same, user data or user data.reverse. With that, it should, if you've got agent in the URL string, it should assign you to the support agent, else give it the supported user. So let's try that. We'll go user equals agent up here. So that should be John. Indeed it is. And down here we should have user equals, user. Be imaginative. And that should be Mary. There you go. Obviously, I could have put anything user equals Mary down here. Now we're deterministic. So before I start adding functionality to the standard application, I just wanted to take a brief aside and show what would be involved to convert the standard application, which uses a direct one-on-one chat, into more of a group chat scenario where you can have more than two people talking in the same conversation. So there's actually a different API call that you would make when you're creating the channel. So you see down here, we call create direct conversation. There's a create group conversation, and then you have to provide it with an array of users who are going to be part of that conversation. So let's just set that up and show you what that would look like, and then we'll end up with a number of users all talking on the same channel over here. So first of all, I know like it's not what you do in production, like I keep saying, but let's just create another user in our user data object here. Okay, there's our user, and then rather than choose a randomized user, we're just going to get the ID again from the query string. So anything after the sixth character, which is user equals, we're going to assume is the ID. So we're going to be looking for a number of the current user. So every one of our users will assign a different ID in the URL query string. And then let's set up the chat itself slightly differently. So my user ID is going to be user.id. And then I'm just going to set the current user to user data. And then we're not just going to have one other person participating in the chat. We're going to have, let's say, three users. So let's create those users. Okay, so I sped through that, hopefully. So I've created the three users, and then rather than call create direct conversation, I want to call create group conversation. And this does take some different properties. Again, more information is available in the documentation, but rather than a single user, that's going to be an array of users. And I'm just going to say user zero, user one, user two. One of these users will be myself, so I don't technically need to add three users here. I could just add the two other users, but this just makes the code simple because at this point, rather than try and figure out which user I am, I'll just add all three, and then I've defined my own user in the ID when I created the chat object. So there we are. This is the users now. And we're going to give it a channel ID. And the documentation says that you have to provide membership data, so I will provide some membership data to the channel. Okay, and then finally, we've got the user object associated with our internal state. So I'm just going to set users to my users array. And with that, we should be done. So let's say this is user one. I think I had a user zero. I did, yep. So we've got John, Mary. I did that possibly around the wrong way, but then let's set up another user over here. So this is going to be user two. And this in theory should be Darren. Yep, because those were the, I'll just show at the very top here. So Darren Campbell. Got initials and I've got an avatar color. So now when I send a message to hi everyone, it appears some issue with the avatar. I'll fix that shortly. And I am John. So yeah, just a little minor issue with my avatar. Let's see what the issue could be there. Don't have a hash sign. And there we have it, all working successfully. So I'm going to undo those changes before I continue with the rest of the tutorial. But hopefully that shows how simple it is to convert a direct conversation into a group conversation. You just have additional user objects. It's just a different API call on the chat object. And then you just provide some metadata and you are good to go. Right, just give me a second here whilst I undo those changes for a group chat. I'll just return the demo to its standard one-on-one conversation default behavior. Okay, and we are back. So we have our two users involved in a direct conversation. Let's add some more features. So let's say I want to have a typing indicator appear here. I will create a div just above my message input. And I have a typers object. So let's declare that typers state at the top. Okay, so we now have the state of who is typing, and that's going to be displayed in our typers indicator. We need to now notify everyone that we have started typing. So I'm going to do that in the onChange handler of the message input here. at the moment, all we're doing is setting the text whenever the input changes, but I also want to now call a method on the chat to say, I am typing. Okay, so it's worth noting at this point that the method I call is start typing, but I'm calling this on the channel object. So the who is typing are just the list of people typing on a channel, and that will differ from channel to channel. So this application only has a single channel, but if you had multiple channels in your application, you would have the ability to detect who was typing on all of those channels. And then finally, just the final piece of the puzzle here is to specify a callback where the chat SDK can tell me that the people typing on that channel have changed. And I'm going to do that as part of the initialization code up here. So I'll just copy this in from here's one I made earlier and save that. This is a very, 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 very simple typing indicator. In fact, I'm not even filtering myself out, so I'm even going to get told when I'm typing myself. So I call the getTyping method, and then I provide it a callback to tell it what to do when the list of people typing changes. So the list of people typing is this data parameter I've got here. This is just the IDs of those typing. So I need to resolve that ID into something, into the name is what I'm doing here. You could obviously do whatever you wanted with that ID, but notice how I'm calling get user on the chat object. That's going to get the user's information from the server, whereas previously all we've been doing is using this local array of users, which doesn't scale. Here, like, this is an example of something that would scale, receiving data from the server. So I am just going to iterate around all of my typers, update the typers indicator, and like that would update the UI. So hopefully that should now work. If I say, hello, Mary, you see the typing indicator exists. And after a specified timeout, 5 seconds by default, the notification goes away. It does also support multiple users. And then as I wait for one of those to timeout, you'll see one user disappear and then the second one. That timeout value is, of course, configurable if I go back up to initialize chat. So I think it's called typing timeout. And then let's set that to 10 seconds, for example. And in fact, let's do 1 second. Otherwise, I'm going to be sat here for 10 seconds not saying anything. And then let me just refresh those so that the initialization code is called again. And now the typing indicator only lasts a second. And next up is channel history. So what PubNub will do for you, it will store all of the messages that have been sent in any of the channels, provided that you have persistence enabled on the key set. So if you have persistence enabled, then you will have access to the get history API, which is actually part of channel. So let's add that in immediately after the get typing that we added previously as all part of our initialization routine. So here I'm specifying that I want 10 messages from the history. You might have thousands and thousands of messages in the history. You probably don't want to retrieve every single message in one call. I mean, that's just going to lead to a very slow application. So what typically tends to happen is you would receive or you would retrieve a specified number of messages. In fact, if you try and ask for more messages than the API is able to return, because the payload would become too big, it will like paginate the response for you. So you can like, there is more, and then you can say get more messages. The UX, you would typically have, like, as you were scrolling, maybe you have it so you're loading in more history as the user scrolls up to previous messages, or maybe you have it more initiated manually. They actually have to press on a load more messages button, for example. The Chat SDK gives you the flexibility to do the UX however you choose to. This is a very simple application, so I'll keep with that simple paradigm, and I'm just going to load in the last 10 messages here of what was in the history, up to 10 messages. If there's fewer than 10, then it will just load in all of the messages. So yeah, history is being loaded into this history object, and then I'm just going to parse the returned array of messages and add that to the eventually add that to the messages array that appears on the screen. Okay, so like I said, this is called in the initialization. So I'm just going to clear the list of messages that were previously on the screen, and then load in for each of the historical messages that I read from the history. I'm going to call this handle message method, which I haven't yet declared. So let me go ahead and declare that now. So complete disclosure, I actually stole this message from one of our other examples, but it does show quite well the maybe more typical client logic. So I keep stressing that at the moment we've declared two users in the system, but normally a client wouldn't always know about every user in the system. Like I say, we can scale to any number of users. Well, like part of that scaling is you don't want to have every user, every client necessarily. So what you have here in this predefined method here is it's going to say, well, look for the user in my users array. If I can't find it, then get the user's information using this chat.getUser that I described earlier, using the user ID. And then once I have that user, add the user to my users array. And then I have full knowledge of every user who has previously sent messages in the in this application. And then finally, just update my messages array with the state variable, which will update the UX. And then when I save that, that should load in all of the previous messages that were sent. So this was from yesterday, but you see these messages down here, hi Mary and hi John, were what was sent earlier in this tutorial. I could send another one, save in history, from Mary to John. I can't spell history, but hopefully when I refresh the page, it does again load in that message from history. Next up is message reaction. So the ability to apply an emoji to a specific message. Maybe it's a happy face, a frowny face, however you want to implement your chat emoji logic. You could obviously be very complex with your emoji. You could present a list of suggested emoji, or maybe there's a more button and the user can select from a whole range of different emoji that they can add to a message. And they could have multiple emojis per user, per message. We support all of those use cases. However, I don't have time to sit here and do that in the tutorial. So it's going to be a very basic. I'm going to have a single button against each message, which is going to react with a hard-coded emoji, and that message reaction update is going to be propagated to every other user. So every user knows the different reactions on each message. That sounds a lot more complicated than it is. So let me just show that being built up in stages. So first of all, we want to have a button against each emoji. So let's add, against each message. So let's add that in here. So we have button. When I click the button, I'm going to define this method in a moment. So I'm going to toggle the message reaction. The message reaction itself is going to be a hard-coded thumbs up. Worth mentioning at this point that the way you use the API is by specifying the emoji as a string. Of course, all emoji are Unicode characters, so you're able to specify them as strings, no problem. And there is a method called hasUserReaction that is available on the message object, the chat SDK message object. You provide it with the specific emoji, and that will return true or false depending on whether the current user has reacted with the specified emoji with the on the specified message. So I'm just using that logic to define the text that's on the button. So it's either going to say remove my reaction or react to this. In fact, if I save that, you should see the result of some earlier testing I was doing here. We have like Mary has reacted to two messages, and she hasn't yet reacted to this message, but John has reacted to this message. But everything's a little bit out of sync, so we're going to put the plumbing in place to make sure that everything stays in sync now. So first of all, though, let's have this handle toggle reaction method. Let's define that. That's going to go up with the rest of my async functions. So that goes here. Now, this is going to take the existing message object. So save in history, for example, this is the chat SDK defined message structure. The message is of type chat SDK message. That's what I'm trying to say. And there's going to be a reaction that gets applied to the message. One message can have multiple reactions. from multiple users, but here we only have the single reaction, the hard-coded thumbs up emoji being set, like I say. When you call toggle reaction, and let me just move this up so you can definitely see it, you are returned a new message object. And that new message is the message with the reaction applied to it, but you then need to make sure that the list of messages that you're displaying in the UX gets updated. So that's the reason for this set messages, just going to update the internal messages state. And when I set that, you should now have the ability to say, yes, I react, or I remove my reaction. But two things. First of all, we're not seeing the reactions. And secondly, we're not seeing when other people react. So we need to add those two pieces of functionality into the application. Fairly simple to do. First of all, let's just do the ability to see a reaction. That makes things a little bit more visual. So we need to go back down to my message rendering. And I need to make sure I'm copying this in the right place. So this is where I display the message text. So, hi, John, save in history. I'm going to define a new span, which is going to be styled with message reactions. I do have some styling I've defined off camera, I should say. And then what that's going to do with the message object, it's going to look at the reactions that have been applied. And the reactions are actually a JSON object whose key is the emoji. If anyone has reacted with this thumbs up emoji, so if the length is not zero, I'm going to say it's been reacted to by, and then I'm going to loop through who has reacted to that message and get the user. Now we're using our local users array, and I'm going to display who has reacted to the message. So here, this message not been reacted to, but now it's been reacted to by Mary. This one's been reacted to by John. And then finally, we need to connect everything together so that John knows when Mary reacts, Mary knows when John reacts, and all of that good stuff. So that is achieved by a stream. It's actually going to be on the thread message object. I won't go into detail of that in this tutorial, but I'm just going to add a new use effect here. Let me move this up so that you can definitely see the code. So stream updates on will be invoked whenever anyone in the channel in the message thread updates a message. So in this example, they're going to be updating the message because they're adding a reaction to it, and I'm going to be notified of that because of stream updates on, and I'm going to update my messages array. I do need to add a dependency finally on thread message, and then that should be it. Here we are. So now I can see I can react as John, and you see both reactions now appearing. I can remove my reaction as Mary. I can remove my reaction. Everything's up to date. Everything's reacted. You can imagine that you could make this look a lot prettier, but hopefully that shows the basic principles of reacting to messages and viewing those reactions regardless of which user you are. So let's add read receipts to our application. Now, read receipts are obviously a way for one client to let other clients in the chat conversation know that they have read a message. It normally consists of two parts. First part is the client declaring that a message has been read. So the Chat SDK will make an assumption that once you mark one message as read, all the messages received prior to that message in the same channel will also be assumed to be read. So there's an API call where you can give a message object and say, this is the last message I read. How you invoke that API will depend on the logic of your chat application. Maybe you mark all messages as read as soon as the channel is opened. Maybe you have to have the user browse the channel for a second. I don't know. I've taken the easy way in this sample app, and I've just defined a button in my UI to say mark as read. So I can mark a particular message as read in my conversation history here. I just have a click handler on that button, and that's going to invoke another message, which I've also predefined. So mark message read. Mark message read makes use, if I scroll up here, makes use of the membership feature of the Chat SDK. So do you remember much earlier on in this tutorial, I mentioned that membership was the association between a user and a channel. Well, here we're using that membership to mark the last read message in the particular channel for ourselves, for the current user. So I need to define, or I need to keep track of the membership state. So like I say, when I create the channel, create direct conversation, this is going to give me, well, actually it's going to give me two types of memberships. It's going to give me the membership of myself, and it's going to be the membership of this other user. But I only want my membership, which is going to be the first parameter. So this is the host membership. And then I just need to make sure that I set the membership to be the host membership. So set membership. And then obviously I need to define a membership state. Whilst I'm here, I'm also going to define a state for the read receipts, which have been received on messages. So there we go. I should now have the logic in place where I'm able to click this button and indicate that the last message that John read is, hi, John. And the last message that Mary read was this save in history. But then just like emoji, I also need some way of displaying that information to the user. So that's going to be back down here in my rendering logic. And then I will define another span. In fact, let me just paste it in and then I'll explain what is going on here. Okay, there we go. So I've defined the span. So I have a class, I have some very basic styling I've predefined. And then I'm just going to say that if there is a read receipts, remember we specified the read receipts state earlier on. We haven't populated that yet. That will be, I'll do that next. But if there is a read receipts associated with the specific messages time token, then I'm going to say it's been read by, and then just obtain the users again from our local users array, find the name of the user, and then just say all of the users who have read that message. Okay. Like I say, if I then save that, we shouldn't yet see anything happen because we're not streaming those read receipts. So then finally, in order to get told that someone has read a message, here we have a different stream API called stream read receipts. So again, as part of my initialization logic, I'm going to add this method in here. So this is going to call stream read receipts on the channel. And whenever the read receipts change, so the Chat SDK is managing the read receipts for you, when they change you'll be notified and you can do what you want with that information. Here I'm just updating that state variable that I defined previously, and then that state variable will be used to display the messages and who has read which message. If you want to stop the stream, you are given the ability to do that in the return here. However, I'm not making use of stopping the stream. Once it starts, it never stops. So here we are. And the logic is already updated. So this message has been read by both Mary and John, the same message. If I update on Mary that I have now read the lower message, remember the Chat SDK assumes that this message and all previous messages have been read. So I'm only specifying the latest in the UX has been read here, but you can imagine maybe you have two ticks or something, or maybe it's a tick for Mary. How you implement the UX is entirely up to you. We just provide you with the capability to easily obtain read receipts. And then finally for this tutorial, I want to touch on some of the user mentioning capabilities of the Chat SDK. So this is the ability with any chat application, you would expect to be able to say hello, and then maybe you have @ followed by the name, so Mary or John. And as you type @ JOH, I would expect to see a drop down that presents me with the list of possible people who I might want to tag in that message. And then once those users get tagged, it's up to the chat application. Maybe they get sent an email, or maybe they get told, hey, do you want to join this new channel? All of that logic is possible with the Chat SDK, but I just want to show a very basic implementation of how you would go about essentially tagging and mentioning users. So the way it works at the code level is you have, previously we were creating the message just within the message input, and then we were hitting send and it was calling send text on the channel. That's the easy and simple way to do things. If you want to start adding rich text, mentioned users, links into your message, the way to do that is by defining a message draft, and then you can add the various aspects of the message into the draft, and then you call send on that message draft object. I'll show you how it works. So let me, and again, more information is obviously in the documentation, but let's define the message within our application state first of all. So this is going to be the message we're currently drafting. So we'll call it new message draft, and we'll say set new message draft. And this is going to be of type message draft. So message draft is a type provided to you by the Chat SDK. And I need to add the closing bracket onto there. So there you go, use state. So we've created our message draft object. Now let's create the message draft whenever we need to write a new message. I'm going to add a use effect for that. You can do this however you want. You just need to make sure that every time the user is going to create a new message, they're doing it on a new message draft. You do have a number of properties that you can define. I think I need to move this code up a bit so you can see it. So here, importantly, we are specifying the user suggestion source of the message. So this is going to be, as I type in at MAR for Mary, at JOH for John, how is it going to pull in that list of users? So here we're saying get the members of the channel. I could have also specified global, so that would be every user that the Chat SDK knows about, but like we only have one channel, so we're just going to use the channel as the user mentioning source. Next, we need to specify or to update the onChange handler of this message input field. So rather than just changing the field itself, we are telling the message draft object that, hey, that what the user has typed has updated. So let's add a new method for that. I'm just going to call this handle input, very generic name, and I'll define handle input next. Just put this with the rest of my async functions, move up. Let me just explain what's happening here, because this is doing quite a lot. So whenever the text in this message input field changes, this handle input gets invoked, and it is getting, it's defining an onChange handler for the new message draft. So it's easier to understand, like conceptually, what's happening here. So every time the input changes, message draft is informed, and then that's going to look at the text and tell you whether or not the input text matches a suggested user. And if it does, then it's going to give you a list of suggested users. If that list is greater than zero, then you can take some action. Here, the action I'm taking is to add that mentioned user to new message draft. And I'm going to, like, if there's more than one user, you'll get multiple indices here. So suggested users here, I'm just adding a single user. This is probably easier to explain it as I'm typing. Okay, sorry, jump cut there, because I forgot that I needed to refresh my page because I changed my initialization logic. But having now refreshed the page, as I type here, everything is like works as normal with a normal message. So hello gets invoked. New message draft is being told, hey, the new text is hello. No users match hello. I haven't even typed the at symbol yet. As soon as I type the at symbol, the message draft is going to look for a user who matches the channel as I specified it here. It could be global, but here I've specified channel as the state. If I type in MAR, you see it immediately replaces the text with Mary Watson. Now, the reason it replaced that text is because of this line down here. So I was just saying, okay, update the text in the text box. Like if it was a production application, rather than just add the mentioned user and replace the text regardless of what the user's intention was, I would probably have presented the user with a drop-down of the suggested users. Whereas here, I was literally just assuming, ah, they must mean Mary Watson, like replace their text with Mary Watson. I could also tag, I mean, there's only two users, so I'm going to try tagging myself. So hello, John and MA. I'm going to type R and it gets replaced. So here you go. I've tagged two different users. And then when I send that message, it just gets sent at the moment as a normal message. So this is a two-step process. The first step is what I've just demonstrated, is adding mentioned users to the message draft. So this particular message had two users mentioned in it. It had John and Mary, and those users just had their names replaced in the text. But the message was still being sent as send text. This is the logic here in handle send. So the next thing we want to do is to update the handle send method to, rather than call send text on the channel, to call send on the message draft that we were actively updating. So let's go ahead and do that now. Yeah, so just to make things simpler, I'll comment out the existing functionality, and I'm going to call new message draft. Remember, this is part of our application, state.send. And then remember, once I've sent that message draft, I just need to make sure that any subsequent message is going to be dealing with a new draft, essentially. The clue's in the name. So I've got some code to copy and paste here. So create new message draft, specify the source again, and set the text of the input field back to, well, it's doing the same as that line there. Now, when I save that, and I try typing the same message, you'll still see the logic of creating the message draft remains the same. So hello at John and at Mary. But now when I send the message, notice how rather than be received as at John, this was sending the text, it's been converted into this rich text, essentially. And again, it's the same down here. And notice, I don't know if you can see this in the video, but it's actually been replaced by pubnub.com/supportagent, or in the case of Mary, pubnub.com/supportedUser. So how is that happening? Where's that coming from? So this is up here. So this is the supported user and supported agent. So we're getting the user IDs, but in actually parsing the messages out, and I mentioned this at the very start of the tutorial, the default behavior of this getting started application, it defines a callback, which is invoked. This is a React callback, not a Chat SDK callback. And it parses out the different parts of the message. So until this last tutorial step, it was only the text part that was being used. And you know, all of that was transparent. Whereas here, because I tagged some users, they have been defined as mentions. So we had two mentions, and what the parsing logic was doing was replacing any mention with https pubnub.com/ the user. Now, you could obviously do whatever you wanted when someone is tagged in a message. Like I said earlier on, some of the use cases, maybe you invite that user to a channel, maybe you send them a notification, you make their username a clickable link so that it navigates to their profile, for example, or it initiates a direct message. All of this is like the chat application logic. You could do what you want with this information. At the Chat SDK, we're just giving you the capability and the flexibility to do what you want. So yeah, the logic here is to just create a hyperlink, and like I could click those. Obviously, they're not going to go anywhere, but just to show you that that is real. How is that for convenience? How can we help you today? Well, hopefully this has been a useful tutorial, very lightning look, especially at the end there, a lightning look at our ability to mention users. I haven't talked about the ability to define links like that aren't mentioned in the text, but obviously that capability exists in the Chat SDK. You can do a lot more with the Chat SDK than what I've shown in this tutorial. We do have a fully featured Chat SDK based tutorial for both web and React Native. well, we're still working on those at the time of recording, but by the time you watch this, those will be out. We have a series of how-to articles that go into a deep dive of the Chat SDK. Again, I'm working on those. Those will be available when you see this tutorial. We have documentation, or if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to either our support team or myself and my other DevRel colleagues at devrel@pubnub.com. We're more than happy to assist you with all of your development or just any questions you have about the Chat SDK. But with that, I've been Darren Campbell, and thank you very much for listening to the Chat SDK tutorial.